Good morning and welcome to worship with us here at Knox Presbyterian Church, Kincardine. We are so glad that you can join us, even though we cannot yet join in person together. We come together in the spirit of sibling Christianity. And we hope that one day soon we will be able to come together and share this time of worship and praise with one another in person. And we hope that that time is not too far away. And now I would ask you if you would please join me in the responsive call to worship. We have come together as those who choose the company of Christ.
Meet us as we gather, Jesus Christ.
We have come in faith to reach out toward our God.
Be with us as we wait, O God.
We have come as those who long for the life of the Spirit.
Come, Holy Spirit, come.
Our opening hymn is number 699, All the Way My Savior Leads Me, number 699. Continue in prayer. Loving and gracious God, as we gather as sisters and brothers in Christ on this Sabbath morning to offer you our worship and our praise, we begin with prayers of adoration and confession. For it is at this time of the week that we pause from our normal and all too often busy schedules to be still and to know that you are with us. And in doing so, we have the opportunity to reflect on the many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. Yes, Lord, we do recognize that all that we have received in this life is from you, and each and everything is a gift along with a blessing. And so we fall upon our knees in adoration, offering you our worship and our praise. We also use this time to look internally, and in doing so, we find those places where we have not allowed your light to shine, the light of our Lord and Savior. And we know that while we might be able to hide this from our neighbors, even our family members, we cannot hide it from you. And so once again, we come humbly before you to ask for your forgiveness, and that you might shower us with your grace and compassion, not only forgiving us for our former trespasses, but using this time where we come together in community to worship you, to strengthen us in our conviction and stamina, to be true and faithful servants of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask that you would take us by the hand, lead us if need be, so that we might walk the path that we have professed we would do. And while each and every one of us is gathered today as an individual, we now hope to come together in one common and unified voice, praying to you the words that were taught to us by Christ himself. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Son of Man has come to seek and save that which is lost. Everyone who trusts in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Therefore, be assured that God bestows upon you his mercy and grants you forgiveness of your sins and leads you to eternal life. Our next hymn is number 646. Lead me, Jesus, I will follow. Number 646.
Testament scripture reading this morning is taken from 1 Kings chapter 2 verses 10 to 12 and chapter 3 verses 3 to 14. Then David slept with his fathers and was buried in the city of David. And the time that David reigned over Israel was 40 years. He reigned 7 years in Hebron and 33 years in Jerusalem. So Solomon sat upon the throne of David his father, and his kingdom was firmly established. Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of David his father, only he sacrificed and burnt incense at the high places. And the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. Solomon used to offer 1,000 burnt offerings upon that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I shall give you." And Solomon said, "Thou hast shown great and steadfast love to thy servant David my father, because he walked before thee in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart towards thee. And thou hast kept for him this great and steadfast love, and hast given him a son to sit on his throne this day. And now, O Lord my God, thou hast made thy servant king in place of David my father. Although I am but a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. And thy servant is in the midst of thy people whom thou hast chosen, a great people that cannot be numbered or counted for multitude. Give thy servant therefore an understanding mind to govern thy people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this, thy great people? It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this, and God said to him, Because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life, or riches, or the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, behold, I now do according to your word. Behold, I give you a wise and discerning mind, so that none like you has been before you, and none like you shall arise after you. I give you also what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that no other king shall compare with you all your days. And if you will walk in my ways, keeping my statutes and my commandments as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your days.
And our second reading this morning is a responsive reading, and so I invite you to join along by reading those words that are printed in bold. We'll be reading Psalm 111. Praise the Lord.
I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the company of the upright, in the congregation.
Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who have delight in them.
Full of honor and majesty are the works of the Lord, whose righteousness endures forever, who has gained renown by wonderful deeds.
The Lord is gracious and merciful. The Lord provides food for the faithful, ever mindful of the covenant.
The Lord has shown the people works of power in giving them the heritage of the nations.
The works of God's hands are faithful and just.
All the precepts of the Lord are trustworthy.
They are established forever and ever,
to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness.
The Lord sent redemption to the people.
The Lord has commanded a covenant forever. Holy and awesome is the name of the Lord.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
All those who live by it have a good understanding.
The praise of the Lord endures forever.
And to continue, we are reading from the Gospel of John 6, verses 51 to 58. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, How can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of me, this is the bread which came down from heaven, not such as the fathers ate and died. He who eats this bread will live forever. Let us hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God for this word to us today.
Our next hymn is number 668. Give us this day our daily bread. Number 668.
You give us more, Lord, help us share.
Let us pray. Grant discernment to these people, my God. Let them listen with care to the words that I will speak, and let them choose wisely amongst them. The truth, let them hug to their hearts and remember. The wrong, let them cast out and forget. Amen. Well, if you've been with us over the last 3 weeks, you know that we've been visiting the Gospel of John. We've been visiting chapter 6 of the Gospel of John for the last 3 weeks. In the first week, we talked about the people who had seen Jesus and were witness to or actually fed in John's version of the feeding of the 5,000. And they gathered again on that shoreline to find him the next day because they wanted more bread. But he is gone. So someone had the idea, well, let's just jump in a boat and go across the Sea of Galilee to Capernaum, because that's where Simon Peter lives. And Jesus and Simon Peter are good friends. So maybe that's where they've gone. And so they did that, and they had that plan that if we do run out into Jesus when we get there, let's be shocked that we found him. And you remember I said, oh, they got there, and they went, oh, Jesus! We didn't know you'd be here, and he saw right through them. And we talked about the need for us to come to Jesus, not to take something from that relationship, but to offer our worship and our praise. And that was week one of John 6, I am the living bread of life. And then last week we went to week two of John 6, I am the living bread of life. And we talked about what it means to be in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. I suggested that may be the core fundamental of Christianity. And we should all be able to articulate that. And not only articulate that is the core fundamental of Christianity, but to be able to personally say, not what the Bible says or some theologian said or somebody else thinks, what you think it means to be in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And I talked about a whole people sort of teasing you that, oh, you've heard of these people. Of course, none of you had heard of my grade 8 teacher or my best friend or anybody else that I mentioned. But I suggested to you that if we draw on the relationships that we have in our personal life with other people and think about those, it might help us to articulate the relationship that we have with Jesus the Christ. Well, I'm going to talk about some more people this week. Hopefully you've heard of these people. I'll be shocked if you haven't. And I'm not just teasing you. I will be shocked if you have not heard of these people. I'm going to begin with the Reverend Kathy Fraser. Now, please tell me you've heard of her. And the reason I mention Kathy is because Kathy and I were talking the other night, and I said, you know, I opened up the lectionary readings because we follow the lectionary, and if you don't know why, I'd be more than happy to discuss that with you at another time. But I opened up the lectionary readings, and it's the third reading of the Gospel of John, chapter 6, I am the living bread of life. And I said to Kathy, how many weeks in a row do I have to talk about the living bread of life? I'm running out of things to say. And she just laughed. And then I said, I don't remember ever having to do this before. And I followed the lectionary my entire ministry. And then it occurred to me that historically, I take my vacation in August. And that's why I've never had to do this before. And it's just now I feel sorry for the people who were filling in for me in August all those years. But historically, that's what I've done. And some of you may be, I know that some of you are aware of the fact that my undergraduate degree is in history. Specifically, it's in the history of World War II. And so what I want to do is talk to you about some of the people of history, and you might recognize these names. Again, I think you will. I think you will recognize these names. I'm going to just rattle off some of the names that I want to talk about. Franklin Delano Roosevelt. You've heard of him. Adolf Hitler. Stalin, Churchill, Eisenhower, Patton. We've all heard of these people. And like I said, my degree is in history and sort of specifically looking at World War II. And if you'd like to stay for the entire day, I can tell you what you need, everything you need to know about those six men. And their, shall we call it, contribution to our history. And some of you that are here today are looking at it going, oh, please don't do that to us. We don't want to hear about this. And so I'm not going to do that to you. But I want you to remember that, I mean, you know these names. Roosevelt, Hitler, Stalin, Churchill, Eisenhower, Patton. And you know that these are people that contributed to our history in significant ways. Notice I didn't say in great ways. Because not all of them contributed in great ways. And their contribution required something from other people. And that requirement was that they, for almost each and every one of these people that I've listed, is that people had to almost blindly follow them wherever they led. In order for any one of those men of history to experience success. And some, they all had that. Some we can argue had success, some we can argue didn't. But they were all successful in having people blindly follow them wherever they were asked to go. We know that about them. We can talk about the facts, we can talk about their actions, we can talk about, well, that's about all we can talk about. We can talk about their history, their actions, and what they did, and the time they did it, and when they did it. But unlike the people that we spoke about last week, and hopefully the people that you spent a little bit of time thinking about in your lives that you have personal relationships with, we cannot have a personal relationship with any one of these six men. And if I can be so blunt, the reason that we cannot have a personal relationship with any one of these six men is simply because they are dead. All six of them have died. So it is impossible to have a personal relationship with each and every one of them. So I'd like to talk to you about somebody else and just some of the sort of the facts of their life, the historical aspect of this other person's life. And again, I will be shocked if you have not heard of this person. I think you have heard of him. His name is Jesus of Nazareth. And I'd like to tell you a little bit about the facts of his life, just in case they're not clear to you. Probably some of these things you do know. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. His mother's name was Mary. After a short time in Bethlehem, Mary and a man named Joseph packed up Jesus and everything they had and headed off to Egypt for a few years until they thought it was safe to return because there was someone that wanted to do harm to this infant child. They came back when it was safe, and they settled in a town called Nazareth, which is in the area of Galilee. Now, we don't know a lot about that time in Nazareth, but we can assume that Jesus was like most little boys. He got up in the morning, he ate three meals a day, he went to school, he played with his friends, His earthly father, Joseph, was a carpenter. He probably picked up some carpenter skills just by watching. And if you think of any little boy that you've known in your lifetime, Jesus may not have been a lot different other than there was something spectacular about him. Around the age of 30, we're told, Jesus leaves home after observing what is going on in society. And he sees a couple of fishermen. He says to them, follow me. I'm still amazed that they just drop everything that they have and follow him without question. I have such admiration for these two fishermen. Along the way, he picks up a few more, and we are told that, you know, there are the 12. And there were others that followed. Over the next few years, he visited different cities around the Sea of Galilee. He is involved in activity and events that we don't seem to be able to explain. Some have been so bold as to call them miracles. He teaches. And a way he teaches is he tells these stories, anecdotes, parables that seem difficult for us to understand. As a matter of fact, if he was your teacher in grade school or high school, you'd probably call him the worst teacher you had because you didn't understand a word he said. But he carries on like that, and he spends time with the 12 and those that are following. And he does some things, and he challenges some people, and he helps other people. And he, possibly most importantly, challenges the status quo. He says, just because this is the way we've always done it, now, I know we would never say anything like that in our church. Well, we've always done it that way. We would never say that. But just because it's the way it's always been done doesn't mean it's the way it should be done. And that's what Jesus would say. I remember saying to one of my professors, like, well, if we're supposed to be disciples of Christ and Christ kind of like to stir the pot, is it my responsibility to leave here, get ordained, and go out and stir the pot? And he said, well, possibly, but can you promise me that you'll be gentle? And I said, I can promise you that I will be as gentle as Christ was. I'm not sure Christ was all that gentle. He did that for a few years. We're told about 3. He stirred the pot so well that he upset a few people in positions of authority, leaders of the established religious institution. And so they asked other authorities who had power beyond theirs to deal with this man that was causing them problems. And they went to a fellow named Pontius Pilate. And Pontius, with some reservation, we're told, agreed to do what he was asked and had this Jesus of Nazareth crucified. So now Jesus is just as dead as Roosevelt, Hitler, Stalin, Churchill, Eisenhower, and Patton. And then something extraordinary happens. And this is where we have to move away from the historical Jesus. You see, modern history says that it can only actually be a historical event if it repeats itself. Okay, so we study specific times. Like I studied history of World War II from 1936, say, to because things started to happen there that led to the war until 1945. And so we take a specific period of time and we look at that and we can legitimately say that that is a historical event because prior to that, there had been war. And since that period of time, there has been war. So it is a legitimate historical study because we are the studying war and war repeats itself. You've heard the expression, history repeats itself. And so that's what we can look at from a historical perspective. And up until this point, we have looked at Jesus from a historical perspective. This was his life from the time he was born until the time he was 33 and he died because pretty much everything that happened in that time, we can argue, had happened or has happened since prior to and since then. But then we all know what happens on Easter Sunday. On Easter Sunday, he rises from the dead. And then the creeds that we say, it says on the third day he rose from the dead and he ascended into heaven and he sits at the right hand of God the Father. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. That, under the terms of modern historical study, is not a historical event. Because it didn't happen before. And it hasn't happened since. It only happened one time. That is critical for us to understand here today. And why that is so critical, and why I go through this whole idea of history and historical events and the definition of it, and why we have to, you have to remember, because this is the third Sunday in the row that we are talking about Jesus Christ as the living bread of life. And up in the first 2 weeks, we have talked about the people who ate the bread that Jesus created out of one of those unexpected things, otherwise known as a miracle, where he fed 5,000 with a couple of fish and a few loaves of bread. And then the next day, they wanted more bread. They wanted more bread. And last week, we talked about the living bread, and we talked about the relationship that we have and what we can contribute to those relationships and what we can receive from those relationships and how those things are important in our lives. They are the bread of our life. But this week, when we deal with the Gospel of John, chapter 6, and the living bread, what we haven't talked about, yes, we've talked about the bread, but we haven't talked about the living. The living. And that's what makes Jesus Christ so different than any other person we can study or have relationship or do anything with in our lives. You see, Jesus is not a person that lived 2,000 years ago in what we now call Israel and Palestine. Jesus Christ is alive today. Yeah, that's how you can have a personal relationship with him. That's how we can experience miracles. And you go, well, we don't experience miracles. I have. If a miracle, by definition, is anything that we are unable to explain, I have experienced miracles. Because I have stood with a group of doctors in the hospital when I worked there, and one doctor says, there is no reason for this woman to be still alive. I don't understand why she is. This woman should have died 4 days ago. I can't explain it. I don't believe in God. It must be a miracle. Those are not my words. Those are the words of a doctor who says, I don't believe in God. It must be a miracle. I can't explain it. Medical science cannot explain why this person is still alive. And so I struggle with the fact, do we spend 3 weeks in a row hearing that Jesus is the living bread of life because it is not something that he said historically, but something that we must recognize that we experience today? He is not the bread of life. He is not the bread of life. You can go get at Sobeys. The bread of life, they have some nice ones. I've tried several different loaves they have. That is the bread of life. That is the bread that sustains physical life. But the living bread of life overcomes death. And I wonder if that's why we need to spend 3 weeks in a row talking about John 6, I am the living bread. Those who eat of me will not die. Those who drink my blood will not perish. You see, those other six people that I mentioned, we can't go talk to them. Do you pray? When you pray, do you believe you're talking to a living God? A living Christ? Of course you do. Why would you waste your time and energy on something that wasn't alive? Why would you waste your time and energy on something that you may not be able to explain, but in the core of your very being, you know is present in your life? Because this Jesus Christ is alive. We profess a living God. And Jesus Christ is the incarnate God. Therefore, he must be alive. Maybe it's just me that needs 3 weeks in a row of the Gospel of John, chapter 6, to figure this out. Because somehow I managed to avoid this for the last 20 years. And the more I thought about it, and the more I prayed about it, and the more I asked about it, and the more I struggled with it, I began to understand the answer to the question that I posed to the Reverend Kathy Fraser. Why do I have to do the living bread of Christ 3 weeks in a row? I'm running out of things to say. But God said, no, Dan. You may have run out of things to say, but I have not run out of things to teach you. I have not run out of time to be with you. I am with you. And you need to understand that. You need to be able to tell others about it. You need to be able to share this. So when people say, what does it mean to be the bread of life? You can get it at the grocery store. What does it mean to be the living bread of life? Well, it might be a miracle. It might be something that we can't understand. It might be something that we have difficulty articulating. But I assure you from my own experience that it is something that brings me great comfort. I think about this past 18 months that we've dealt with a global pandemic. I think about the other things that are going on, the forest fires in British Columbia, Northern Ontario, and California, and Greece, and they seem to be happening all over, the floods in Germany and England. There seems to be something all going on that should, if we are reasonably rational and intelligent people, scare us more than we can understand. And yet, for some reason, I'm not terrified. I'm not overly comfortable with it. I'm not glad that these things are happening, but I am not terrified. Because I do believe that the living bread is not a historical event, but something that walks with us each and every step of our lives today. And if that is true, and I believe it to be true, then the miracles and the teaching and the resurrection and the healing and all those things that we read about in Scripture can happen today. These are not things that happened to other people a long time ago. These are things that if we are aware, if we are open to them, if we are willing to walk the path that we have professed to walk, that we will experience in our lifetimes. And for that, I say thanks be to God. Amen. At this time in our service, we would bring our offering. share the gifts that we have been blessed with this community. And while we are unable to meet in the building, I know that so many of you have been so generous with your offerings and recognizing that even though we can't be in the building, there are still financial responsibilities of the ministry that takes place here. And I thank you for your generosity. If you have been really difficultly touched by this pandemic and are experiencing hardship, I would ask you to reach out to your elder, the church office, or myself, and we will do whatever we can to offer you assistance. Let us continue in prayer. Loving and gracious God, we come now before you to give you thanks. Let us first give thanks for the opportunity to gather as sisters and brothers in Christ and offer you our worship and our praise, and to be able to do that without fear of oppression or ridicule. And what a great blessing it is to be able to freely assemble and to profess our faith, to use your scripture to learn and mature in our relationship with you, to sing hymns of praise and offer you our prayers and supplications. We pray for those throughout the world who do not know such privilege, those who do risk even mortality to offer you worship and praise. We pray for them and we ask that they might experience the same blessing and privilege that we do. We give you thanks for this building that protects us from the elements and allows us to focus solely upon you. We give you thanks for the many volunteers who work quietly behind the scenes to ensure that everything is just as it should be when we arrive. We give you thanks for the leadership in our church, our session, our board, our presbytery, our synod, and our national assembly. And we ask that you would bestow each and every one of them with the knowledge and wisdom required to lead us into the future. We give you thanks that we live in a country of relative peace and harmony. We pray for those throughout the world who experience oppression, prejudice, and violence. We give you thanks that you have opened our eyes to the injustices of our country. And we pray that you will guide us to shine your light in these times of darkness, to offer your love to those who suffer, and your compassion to those who are ill in all aspects of their being because of the experiences they have had in their lives. We also give you thanks that we do not know what it means to be hungry or homeless or naked, but there are those within our very city that do. And we ask that you would help us to let go of our fear and greed so that we might share the many blessings you have bestowed upon us with those who have so little. We give you thanks for those who serve or seek to serve in government office, whether it be municipal, provincial, or federal. And we ask that you would open their eyes to the abundance of your creation so that they might govern accordingly, rather than from a place of fear and scarcity. We give you thanks for your holy word, the word that comforts and challenges us. We ask that you will continually enlighten us as we study, discuss, debate, and question each and every word that has been gifted to us. As we prepare to conclude this time of formal worship, we ask that you would remind us that we must never cease to worship you, and that we must worship you with every thought, with every word, and with every deed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 368, Let Christian Faith and Hope Dispel, number 368. Thank you.
against all dangers will defy, and war and conquer all. Nor death, nor life, nor earth, nor hell, nor time's destroying sway can e'er erase us from his heart, or
now go in peace and never be afraid, with the knowledge and understanding that God is with us in all that we do. And may the grace of God our Creator, the compassion of Christ our Savior, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you not only at this very moment, but with each and every step of your journey. Amen.
Spirit of